Welcome back to Victory in the Word. I'm your host for the day, Sarah Schallenberger from H22 Ministries, where we are about the purpose of God, the plan of God, and the power of God for your life and for mine as well. So we're taping our segments of Victory in the Word at 2626 South Loop West. That is Kingdom Broadcasting Network under our founder, Apostle Joshua Mitchell, who has his own show, the flagship show, Glory Live, which airs on kbntv.tv, along with a host of other wonderful lineup of Christian broadcasters, everybody from Apostolic Voices to Miss Tamara Pope, to Dr. Sugar Trask, to Dr. Larry Cook, to Miss Tiffany Nicole with Virtuous Woman, the Virtuous Woman's Hour. And then we have Ken and Mary Bostrom, and we have Adam Glasner, and all sorts of good lineup Christian TV. So anything that you're looking for, we the mandate of Kingdom Broadcast Network is to fill the airways with the good news of the gospel, that you can be saved, you can be healed, you can be delivered, you can be filled with the power of God, and you can be walking in the purpose that God has for you. So we are taping these segments in 2019, and we're still in the middle of our Design Your New Year 2019, making plans and taking ground. And if you haven't gotten a copy of this, you can Facebook Sarah Schallenberger, and we will get one of these into your hands. And this is about the power of speaking God's word, how God's word and our word partner together will set the course and the direction of our lives and every part of our lives, from our health to our finances to our marriage, to our ministry, to our thinking, and to our emotions. And so your words and my words, the Bible says, contain power. That's Proverbs 18:21. Our words are creative. They will create attitudes and actions and atmospheres and new things like paintings and businesses and churches and orphanage and all sorts of things like that. That's Genesis 1:26. We're made in the image of God. His words create on the level of deity, and ours create on the level of humanity. And then James 3:4, your words and my words are directional. They're the rudders of our life. They will tell our emotions and our hearts and our physical bodies what to do, and we can direct where we're going by speaking ahead. So that's James 3:4. So in the last of the last days, we want the body of Christ plumb line to the word. And so the process of speaking the word on a day-to-day basis, believing and confessing, gives us a good ability to renew our mind to the word, to have our emotions line up to the word, and then to start speaking the very plan of God that he has for us. And so there's, the plan of God, if you're not sure exactly what the details are, for all believers across the body of Christ, we want to start with confessing the written word, who we are, identity. We're new believers in Christ, we're new creations in Christ. Everything old about us is gone. Everything new about it has come and is now true. 2 Corinthians 5:17, we want to be speaking healing verses, confessing who we are. Jesus is our healer. We're the healed of God. He's the healer. We're the healed. Identity, identity. Exodus 15:26. And then prosperity verses. God has given you, God has given me power to obtain wealth so that his covenant can be established here on this earth. His word surpasses, is settled forever in heaven. It doesn't change. You can bank all of your hope and your heart on his word. It is up and running into eternity, is for both genders, all races, all ages, and all economic starting points. So the word works. So we want to have the word coming out of our mouths on a regular basis. The power of our words combined with the power that's in God's word, sending it back to him. Isaiah 55:11 says that it'll accomplish the very thing it was sent to do. So we want to have a good repertoire in our mouths, going out of our mouths every day on God's word, on healing, prosperity, overcoming. I can do all things. There's nothing impossible for me. I'm strong and courageous, not afraid, not discouraged. God's with me at all times, will never stop helping me. Joshua 1:9. So along those lines, we're Facebook living in the morning hours. You can catch it on Sarah Schallenberger Facebook timeline, and we're running through a good smidgen of these, a good representation of these verses. And so our invitation to you is to follow along with us and start confessing along with us. We do basically the same verses every day, so you can start getting yourself in a routine. So you want to be setting aside time to speak God's word. And so His word is what? It's a lamp. Lamp unto our feet, light to our path. It'll show you where you are and where the Lord's taking you. What's the situation? What's going on? And then what to do about it? How to move forward from where you're at? Lamp and light. That's his word. And so that brings us to what we're going to be talking about in today's segment, which is designing your new year and making plans and taking ground. There's an element of it for all of us that we're going to always come back to this idea of that you and I are designed for purpose. And so whether you're looking at 2019 and you're thinking, I already am on my right plan, I already know I'm on the right path God has for me, or maybe you fall in like that age group of 12 to 24, you're maybe to be college bound, or you're about to graduate from high school, and you really don't know the direction that the Lord has for you on your life. And so you are the person that we're speaking to, or if you're in the body of Christ and you know you belong to Jesus, but you just don't know what you're supposed to be doing. And so that's what we're going to talk about a little today. So we're starting with this idea of identity, of the fact that we're not just created. You know, Adam and Eve were created beings, and then we all were procreated after that by the process of procreation that God set up. But we were all handpicked and designed by the Lord, regardless of who your natural parents are and their decision to put a pregnancy into motion. God's, where he intersects and where he puts his design on every single person is that he picked the spirit that the Bible says was with him before the foundations of the earth, and he decides where to deposit that spirit into which pregnancy, at what time, and on what location on the earth. That's Acts 17. And so Psalm 139 talks about that and how the Lord's decision, a man and a woman's decision, will be to put a pregnancy into motion. But it's the Lord's decision then to knit that person's spirit in, and within that spirit is a blueprint that has all the plans and the agenda that God has for that person while they're on this earth. And so we want to talk about that. It's a good place to start. Psalm 139, verse 16, and we'll just come on over here, is Psalm 139, verse 16 says that then in the heavens there's a book for all of us, and that in that book, that has all of our days written in it before one of them came to be. And so here's the idea that when you come hit and on planet Earth, even if you're an unplanned pregnancy, or if you were maybe the product of two parents that weren't married, or even the product of an assault, or however the pregnancy got put into motion, once you're on the planet, you've been knit together for purpose. You're designed to be here. You're designed for a particular location, a particular purpose, and a particular plan of God. And he has a book that he already wrote on your behalf with every day in it detailed out his plans for you. They're Jeremiah 29:11 plans. They're plans that will only do you good. They will bless you, prosper you, and do you no harm. So in the New Testament, the correlating verse that goes with that is Ephesians 2:10 that says, you and I are God's workmanship. We are actually created in Christ Jesus. So this talks about our design that we have when we're knit together in our mother's womb. This talks about when we're born again, John 3:3, and the Holy Spirit comes and rebirths our spirit, that we are God's workmanship. And that we are designed or created to do good work that he himself has prepared, that's the key word, prepared for us to do, prepared for us. And so wherever you are, whatever your age range is, if you're a 15-year-old watching this, or you're a 23 or 24-year-old, maybe you're out of college, or maybe you're a young mother and you're watching this, you're in your early 30s. Or maybe you're in your second or third season in life, you're on the other side of 50, or you might be retired, and you just have this sense of, I'm not sure, I know what I've done already, but I'm not sure where to go from here. Well, this is your starting point. This is your starting point, is that there's purpose and there's destiny, there is plan and a blueprint on the inside of you. And so the Bible says that that's how we're designed. So things that go along with our design, and again, this is kind of a little bit of, this is background information, but it's going to be a good foundation for what we're talking about when we talk in our next segment about the hearing the specific plan of God for your life. other things that are helpful to understand about you as somebody that's been designed is that Proverbs 23:7, and that verse says that as a man or a woman thinketh, so he or she is. And one of my favorite sources of teaching on anything to do with the thinking process and the plan of God and the purpose of God for your life is Dr. Carolyn Leaf. She's a spirit-filled believer, and she's also a neuroscientist, and she's spent her entire career researching the brain and making the connection for people on Proverbs 23:7, that as a man or a woman thinketh, so they are. And she, part of her ministry is in helping the Romans 12:1-2 process to take place. And that's the renewing of the mind, is getting people to understand that a mind that's set on things above is at peace, that a mind that thinks according to the word is productive and peaceful and creative and can solve problems, that a mind that's set on the word, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, is a mind that has that can think with confidence, and there's bravery in the heart, and there's a very good atmosphere in the brain of good chemical, positive chemical reactions, where there's healthy dopamine levels and serotonin levels, and all of the neurons are firing the way they should because the thinking is correct. It's the thinking is on the faith side. The thinking is on the life side. Remember what we said, that it's not just our words that contain life or death, but our thought can also go on the life or the death side. And science has shown when you do MRIs that when you have a brain that thinks on things above and thinks according to the word of God, that there's positive electrons that are charged and that they're discharged, and there's positive levels, there's healthy levels of all the chemicals we need. And our brain, you have a healthy brain. You have a brain that a person that is their nervous system is calm. And then the opposite, when you have a brain that's filled with fearful thinking or what if this, you know, doubtful thinking that doesn't have the word as the basis or doesn't know enough word or their thinking isn't plumb line to the word, then you can have a brain that's in a state of anxiety or chaos or confusion. You can have a brain that there's so much anger that it's hard to think clearly. You know, you see red. And so there's not a clear thinking process going on. So a brain can go in either direction depending on the thought. So that's part of this verse, Proverbs 23:7. As a man or a woman thinketh, so he is. And so in the brain, when you're thinking positive, when you're thinking word, when you're thinking life, the thoughts of the Lord, that he's with me at all times, he'll never stop helping me, then your brain reflects that very healthy environment. You have peace, you have joy, you have a sense of well-being. About you, you're healthy in your spirit, you're healthy in your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions, and your physical body reflects that, and your brain is physically healthy, chemical levels are healthy, and so this is what we go for in the body of Christ. So there's another element, and this is the one I want to bring out today. There's another element, though, to this verse, just like there is on most Bible verses, is that there's more than one facet to them, and that's the fascinating thing of the Word. We're never going to get off studying the Word. You know, in eternity, I will be teaching a class, you know, somewhere on the planet, you know. I will be teaching the Word just like I teach now, you know, and we'll be preaching Jesus, and we'll be preaching the cross, and we'll be preaching who we are in Him and what we're here for. And all the good plans that he has for us. We'll still be doing that into eternity. But so you never wear out of the word. The word's eternal. We're created by the word, the spoken word for sure. And all things are held together by the written word and the spoken word of God. So the word is up and running for all of eternity. So another part of this, Proverbs 23:7, is that our brain is separated into seven different lobes, and that every part of our brain has a different function that it is responsible for. And you can look this up online. You can just Google seven lobes and then the different areas that our brain, different parts, the tissue parts that are responsible for different functions of our body. So some of the areas are here, I've got them written down, are things like part of our brain is just for the thinking, the planning, and the decision making. So this is kind of like the will part. It's the part that does the processing and thinks and reasons and then makes decisions. Then you've got a part in your brain that is over your emotions. So they're going to be getting stimuli or getting information around them and then processing it, and it's going to be manifested, and they're going to classify it as good, bad, or scary or not scary, and then there's going to be emotions that come. That takes place in one part of your brain. Memory is another part of the brain. Language is a part, how you classify things, your vision, all your optics, motor skills, all of that stuff is part of the brain. And in addition to that, there's also some parts that are the parts that are responsible for language versus, and we know this, right brain, left brain, language and art versus math and science. You know, thinking outside the box and wanting to put paint on everything that you own, or having everything monochrome colored and just coloring within the lines, you know, engineer thinking. There's different types of parts of your brain that specialize in more what we would call like linear black and white thinking, engineer type thinking, or more creative type thinking. So there's actual locations in all of our brains that have that. We're designed that way. So but what we want to bring out is this idea that, remember, the Bible says, as a man or a woman thinketh, so he is. And a big key to this, and this was something that really helped me to understand, not just the idea that the Lord had designed me for purpose, but that I was designed for that purpose before I was put together, I was made in a certain way, so that there were some things I was really designed to do in the body of Christ and for the kingdom of God. And that because I was designed to do them, I would have a knack for them, and I would be blessed when I did them. But then the opposite is also true, that there would be things that my brain is really not designed to do. I really don't have the capacity to do, or they're not my strength areas, and those are not going to be areas I'm going to be called in. And that's important to understand. So here we go. So back to this idea. So the fascinating thing about our brains, with all these different parts of them, is that every 2 seconds, we have an electrical current that pops between all 7 of those areas within 2 seconds. All of us do. Our brains are constantly firing. We have neurons that constantly fire, and they fire and move between all 7 of those areas every 2 seconds. But what's unique, remember what we've always said, your calling is like a thumbprint. Your design that you have on you is like a thumbprint. Well, your brain is too, because, and this is where it comes from, because although everybody has neurons that travel with all 7, the order in which the neurons travel, some people start with the visual arts and then go into like the interpersonal, where they like to be around people, they're extroverts, and then it travels to the part of the brain that has to do with being liking your time, processing things by yourself, or being introverted. And then it'll go, you know, we all have a pattern that those neurons travel that's unique to us. And in addition, those neurons move and spend microsecond different amounts of time in each one. So when you put it all together, even if you have, so that our brains really all do not all work the same. Our brains are, some brains are wired on the neuron level. It's not something that we do. You're born with it. It's by design. Your brain functions in a way that you are heavy on the engineering side, the logical side, and most of your time is spent there in the brain. The neurons are spent there, and then you might have that partnered with being a very extrovert, and so you might find yourself as an engineer type person, but you really like being around people, and you get all your energy from people, and so you are the person that decides to have, you know, they go into an engineering that has to do with building bridges or some social project where you're out and about and you have your own engineering company and you like working with people, but you love and thrive on this engineering part. And then you've got plenty of engineers that are just, their brain goes this way, but then the brain also then goes in the direction of they need lots of time by themselves. They don't want to interact with people. That frustrates them, but they really like ideas. And so then you've got your designers, they can be your engineers with a very stoic personality, you know, when they want, give me the numbers, you know, give me a problem to solve, you know, put me in an office somewhere and close the door and I'll be happy, you know. So you've got various unlimited variations in any brain pattern. And so why do we bring this up? Is because you really are designed for purpose. And so to the degree that you can understand that, you don't need to, and you can't be, you cannot be looking around you, even in your home church, or you're this or you're that, and say, There's nobody, you know, there's somebody that thinks just like I, there's nobody that thinks just like you do by design. There's nobody whose brain works exactly the same way. Even if we all share the same written word in our spirits, there's unity in our spirits, our brains do not all work the same. And so it's important to understand how your brain is designed to function and to go with that and not frustrate yourself to say, but it looks like Sally Sue, she gets more attention because her, you know, she's more this of a personality, or she does this, or is Joe Bob, or, you know, or they make more money because they have an attorney mind and I don't have, you know, you don't want to frustrate yourself. You need to know that each of us is fearfully and wonderfully made. There's a reason why your brain works the way it does. It needs to be on the life side. Whoever is designed to work needs to be on the life side, but how it works is very unique to you. And when you start asking the Lord, thank you, Lord, for showing me how my brain, what is it that really makes me tick and work the way that I'm designed to work? You know, teachers, if you want to make a teacher happy, you let them teach. That's just, you know, teachers think a certain way. They learn by teaching. They love teaching. They thrive on teaching. They'd rather teach than eat. You know, it's just there's certain things, you know, painters are the same way. When I, you know, painters are the same way. Really anybody, when you put them in their element, they will flourish. And so you want to know how you're designed. And it's more important for you to know that you can trust a good Heavenly Father, that He didn't make you wrong. He didn't leave you out. He didn't leave you in the cold. He made you fearfully and wonderfully made. Your brain is the most amazing thing. And the way you're designed to be is just how you're supposed to be. And it's for purpose, because you've got something you're going to be called to do that only you can do. Your brain is part of it. Gender is also part of your calling. It's because there's order in the kingdom. We have been given a very loving Heavenly Father that set out two wonderful genders. It's really genius, actually, that He's put on the men's. There's the mandate for spiritual leadership and protection, which is they are built for that. They are the Tupperware in the body of Christ. You know, everything rolls off their back. They look at the big picture. They set the structure out on things. They do the preaching of the redemption. They set up the organization. You know, they have the structure they put in place. And then you have the women that come and follow. They're under that protection that are the detail. So we're the fine china. We're the ones that are going to look and we're going to see, okay, now what? How do we put the detail in? How do we talk about the details of hearing the call of God in your life? How do you put together, you know, there's different male and female thinking is different, you know, and the way that I've always saw it play out in my marriage, I always give this example. Because it's a good one, is the taking care of our outside. You know, my husband's always done the broad paint stroke. He always has been the one to keep all of the grass cut, all of the borders of everything trimmed, the trees in shape, the fences are cut, everything on the broad brushstroke of our landscaping has always been done very faithfully and excellently by my husband. I'm here. He does his job. That allows me to come in then with my gifting, how I think as in my gender, which is details. And so I come in and I'm like, okay, now let's get some design. Now let's get some flowers. Now let's get some color. Now let's get some signs. Now let's get some this and that and put the whole thing together. So structure and details, structure and details. That's one way that there's a difference, that's one role difference between the genders. There's others as well. And so, but that's a good one. And so your gender is going to be part of your calling. If you are, the gifts, and we've talked about this many times, ministry gifts, Ephesians 4, are given across gender lines. So we have fivefold ministers in both male and female. But even within that, there's a supernatural order or protection given to us as a blessing that the men provide the spiritual protection so that the women can come under them and can function in the ministry that the Lord's called them to. And so that's a blessing as well. That's going to be part of what God's called you to do. And then the other issue that will be particular to you when you're looking at how am I designed? What are the things that God's put in me? There's not just a plan. There's not just a book that's been written about you, Psalm 139:16. There's not just good works that have been prepared for you, Ephesians 2:10, that once Christ, the Holy Spirit, came into you that now you're prepared to do. There's not just a certain way that your brain works, Proverbs 23:7, and there's not just gender identity that you've been given, but you also have a very individual spirit about you or the heart. or what I like to say is a level of sensitivity. And you can see that by observing people, that some people, you can jump out and, you know, you can put loud music on and it's just not going to bother them. Other people are very sensitive to any kind of stimuli, light, sound. They're sensitive in their emotions. You put them in a room, they will pick up any emotion in that room. They're just sensitive. Intercessors typically are that way. You know, it's because they can pick up on things that are not said. They can pick up, and you have to know that your level of sensitivity is going to be part, that's going to play a part in what your purpose is in the kingdom. And so, and again, to the degree that you know it is the degree that you won't be frustrated. And I always tell this story, and I always tell it by way of encouragement. You know, when I was growing up, I fell under the category of being very sensitive. And so I could go and I could tell, and I really didn't realize that other people, generally speaking, weren't the same way. And so I could go into a situation, I could get a read on people, get a read on a teacher. I don't know how many times in college where they asked to have like an evaluation given, and I would just be giving the person advice from the Bible, really. This was before I was spirit-filled, because I had picked up on this, that, and the other thing just by being in their presence. And so I would just take it as an opportunity to give out a word. And so I've always done that. And, you know, anyway, there at one point, you know, there was some discord between me and some people that I was living with. And so we went and we all did some counseling, and the counselor was very adept at understanding this, gave us tests, and she laughed when she saw the results and said, the reason is because, you know, your sensitivity level's up here, you're seeing X amount of stuff, and then, you know, the people you're dealing with, theirs is down here, and so you guys are a myth. So yes, it's true. You're walking around going, how come nobody sees this? And they're saying, what are you talking about? You know, and that kind of stuff is helpful to know. And so, again, we're going to keep talking about this in our next segment, but you know, as you are looking into the rest of this year, and you're just thinking, what's the plan of God in my life? If you need this resource of getting God's word out of your mouth, then let us know. Let us know how we can pray for you. Contact us at Sarah Schallenberger Facebook, and then join us with our next segment as we're going to talk a little bit more about hearing the plan of God for your life, how he speaks, and how you can start walking in that plan for you in 2019. So until next time, we thank you for joining us, and we'll see you soon at Victory. Victory that's in the Word.